It was magnificent.
One of his pictures are equivalent to 10 of somebody else's.
Oh, Nicole. And shake his head.
Do you know him? And nobody ever really knew him.
He was known as a kind of future threat.
One of the all-time great motion picture makers.
A future threat to peace and quiet.
Legendary. Meanness.
There were times he drove me crazy.
He was a very lovable individual.
I love him one minute, and the next minute I hate him. I could kill him.
Perhaps the most intelligent person I've ever met.
He got fascinated with Nescafe commercials.
Have you seen the film Groundhog Day?
Because they told stories so fast.
Well, that's what it was like.
This man was born to push the envelope.
There is still a part of Stanley that's a great mystery to me.
And he always pushed the envelope.
And you must expect someone like that to be different from the rest of us.
I think we were too scared of him over here.
Everybody pretty much acknowledges he's the man. And I still feel that underrates him.
This film is about the life and work of Stanley Kubrick, an outstanding filmmaker, one of the great artists of our time. Stanley Kubrick was an enigma to many people. In his films, he was extrovert, challenging, and ready to break conventions. But Kubrick himself was intensely private, shunning publicity, and fiercely guarding his anonymity, happiest at work and at home with his family and a large circle of friends. He was a chess player in every sense, both cautious and aggressive. He took great risks, but evaluated each move with the greatest of care. Stanley was born in New York and remained a New Yorker all his life, even though he and his family lived in England for nearly 40 years. He died at his home on the 7th of March, 1999. This film will make use of unique material which has never been seen before. It is a document about a man who remained silent whether he was being applauded or damned. Stanley Kubrick was born in New York on the 26th of July, 1928. His father, Jack, was a doctor who married Gertrude Perveller the previous year. His sister, Barbara, was born 6 years later in 1934.
Today, a lot of people that have kids that are that far apart, they encourage the older one to nurture the younger one as a baby, and so they sort of get to love them. But I gather Stanley was very jealous, you know, that I was there. He was very good, though. He was very good to me.
Nobody ever accuses him of being playful.
Well, he was playful like on the Addams Family kind of playful. When he was little, I think they did consider him kind of a sissy. Because he wasn't like your typical boy. He read a lot. He always had a book. Well, my mother read all the time. She always was behind him, always. And she really believed it. She says, there's nothing you can't do. She always was supportive of him. She was really a great mother, I think.
Were they strict, Bert and Jack?
No. Never. He always did what he wanted.
In 1941, when Stanley was 12 years old, he went to Taft High School in the Bronx.
at the beginning, I think, of the second week, Stanley turned to me as the class opened and said, could I let him copy the day's homework? I said, of course, why not? Well, the next day he asked the same thing. And the next day after that, and before I knew it, he was doing it every day. So after about a week or 10 days, I finally got up enough aggressiveness to say, Stanley, you know, why aren't you doing your homework? He said to me very simply, and in his what I learned was his characteristic quiet way, well, I'm not interested. It wasn't as if he were stupid. He was simply not interested and acted upon that.
Stanley was really quite involved, quite passionate about photography. As Stanley, you must understand, was by the general lights of the time the son of a wealthy person, as they had their own home. And they could have a dark room. And his father was interested in photography, and I think he encouraged Stanley to use the dark room and to become a photographer. That dark room background actually was one of the bedrock things that enabled him to develop a very high level of sophistication about photography and then finally cinematography.
Stanley was fascinated by photography. He was the photographer on the school newspaper and was constantly on the lookout for pictures that would capture the imagination.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin. A press association has just announced that President Roosevelt is dead.
Roosevelt was a god to us. That's what my mother said. She said, I'm not sure there's a God, when he died. And then when he took that picture, whoa. It just made everybody that saw it would cry, that just start to cry. He looked like just the world had ended. And Stanley just got that.
It was this photograph of a news vendor mourning the death of President Roosevelt that transformed the amateur into a professional. Stanley was just 16 when he sold this picture to Look, one of America's great illustrated magazines. When he graduated high school, he joined Look as a staff photographer, taking thousands of pictures, perpetually experimenting and gaining valuable experience for the next stage of his career. Kubrick shot several features on boxing for Look. One on the rising young fighter, Walter Cartier. Passionate about the sport, he realized he had found the subject for his first film.
Day of the Fight was Stanley's first effort at filmmaking. I was his assistant on that. And I'm very proud of the fact that I operated the second camera during the final fight sequence, which is a real fight. And we were alternating with each other. I was shooting when he was loading. I got the knockdown because Stanley was loading.
He's done it. He's KO'd Bobby Jayne. This is a fighter, Walter Cartier. He's just moved up one more place in a line that may end with a championship.
Following Day of the Fight, Kubrick quit his job at Look and devoted himself to making films. He moved to Greenwich Village and for the next few years supported himself by making short documentaries, hustling chess in Washington Square, and playing tournaments for prize money. But chess winnings were never going to be enough to fund an entire film. So in 1953, Kubrick's father cashed in his life insurance to help his son make Fear and Desire, a film about a fictitious war. It was Kubrick's first feature.
She'll see us.
Shut up.
he was absolutely and totally involved in the making of this movie. He knew nothing about acting. I probably didn't know much more. He was not a bohemian. He was not an avant-garde left-bank figure. He was a kid from the Bronx who was smart. I don't think he had too much education. He was a very good chess player. It's the intensity impressed me. I thought he had a vision of some place he was going.
Fear and Desire was a youthful apprentice exercise. Kubrick would later withdraw the film from circulation, but he got him noticed and helped to get him financial backing for his next feature. Killer's Kiss revealed Kubrick's extraordinary ability to play with light.
Stanley was making his second film, and I wanted very much to be the still photographer. So I also wanted to see somebody discovering, somebody learning. I knew I'd be seeing that. This was Stanley at a point where he had no physical resources at all. On Fridays, he dismissed the company for a couple of hours, went to the unemployment line and collected his unemployment check, because that's what he was living on. It was $30 a week, and he just about made it.
He was very ambitious, and he knew that this was going to help him, because once there was a scene in the morning, and the crew wasn't being paid much either, and everybody was in a bad mood, and Stanley said, well, why don't we just take the afternoon off? So I was amazed. Could he give us the day off? But he always drove me home. So on the ride home, I said, why are you always so nice to everyone? He said, honey, nobody's going to get anything out of this movie but me.
The theatrical release of Killer's Kiss brought Kubrick to the attention of James Harris, an up-and-coming producer who had access to finance. They teamed up to form Harris Kubrick Pictures.
The only thing is, we didn't have anything to do at the time. We had no subject to deal with. So that night, I left the office and went to a bookstore and found a book there about the robbery of a racetrack.
I don't suppose there's anything for dinner.
Well, of course there is, darling. There are all sorts of things. We have steak and asparagus and potatoes.
I don't smell nothing.
Well, that figures, because you're too far away from it.
Too far away from
it? Certainly, you don't think I had it all cooked, do you? It's all down the shopping center.
I thought he was a kid. Both he and Jim were so very young. I'm guessing, but I think Stanley was only 26 at the time. I don't think anything was difficult for Stanley. He had this tremendous confidence. And if he hadn't, I don't think he could have worked with Lucian Ballard as he had.
The cameraman was Lucian Ballard. And Lucian had, I believe, won an Academy Award, was regarded as one of the top dozen or so photographers in the business, and was a particularly stylish fellow. Married to Merle Oberon, a classic example of the old-style cinematographer.
Stanley really had done his own photography on those two films that he had done previously, so he knew exactly what he wanted. And I think that Lucian Ballard kind of resented this young fellow from New York.
The first shot of the picture, first day, first shot, Stanley set up a shot. It was quite complex. It was a long dolly shot. And he's lined it up specifically with a 25-millimeter lens. And he set it up and turned it over to Lucian. And Lucian said, fine, and began the elaborate business of lighting and setting a dolly track and so on. And Stanley went over to talk to Jimmy or do something and looked back sort of over his shoulder and noticed that the dolly track was much further away from where he had set the camera. He said to Lucian, what are you doing, Lucian? I put the camera here. You're pulling it way back. Why haven't you put it where I've asked for it? He said, well, I haven't changed anything. I'm using a 50-millimeter lens to give you precisely the same coverage that you've asked for, but it's with the 50, and I've used the 50 because it makes my job a lot easier and it'll go a lot faster. And Stanley listened to this and said, but what about the change in perspective that occurs? He said, well, that really doesn't matter that much. That particular piece of information, of course, is dead wrong. The perspective changes. It's a different shot. And Stanley was aware that Lucian was simply bullying past him. But also, what particularly nettled him was the assumption that he wouldn't understand this or wouldn't care about it. And Stanley said, put the camera where I told you, with the lens that I asked for, or get off the set and don't come back. He said it very quietly, very softly, and there was a look between them. And Lucian changed the setup and moved the camera where it had to be, and there was never an argument again about anything.
All right. Check it through.
Passengers.
Thank you, sir.
Now
I'm sure you'll find the service
American
to your complete
Airlines,
satisfaction.
Mike Porter, the New Englander.
I suppose that a lot of what Stanley is and what he in more complicated ways did with later films is implicit in that rather simple little movie about this meticulously planned crime. This sense that the Sterling Hayden character has that he's really on top of that. He really knows what he's doing. And the fact that at the end of the movie, the little yapping dog gets loose and the prop wash goes and the money blows all over the place. I mean, it's sort of a brilliant movie, and it is an existential movie. I mean, that is to say, if existentialism basically posits that we define ourselves by doing, and the chance is the one thing we can never quite fully comprehend prior to its impinging on our desires or our plans or whatever it is. It's a brilliant statement of that.
The Killing was not a commercial success, but the ingenious caper story did succeed in building Kubrick and Harris's reputation.
When I saw The Killing, I said, my God, Stanley's going to make it. This is good. But it's Paths of Glory that turned it all around.
Walked in the middle, as we usually did when we were kids, in the middle of a movie, Paths of Glory. And myself and my friends, who were kind of war film buffs, we had never seen anything quite like it. We'd never seen anything quite like the tone of it. We had seen other anti-war films, but this one was so honest, particularly the trial scene and the scenes between MacReady and Kirk Douglas.
I ordered an attack. Your troops refused to attack.
My troops did attack, sir, but they could make no headway.
Because they didn't try, Colonel. I saw it myself. Half of your men never left the trenches.
A third of my men were pinned down because the fire was so intense.
Don't quibble over fractions, Colonel. The fact remains that a good part of your men never left their own trenches. Colonel Dex, I'm going to have 10 men from each company in your regiment tried under penalty of death for cowardice.
Penalty of death?
For cowardice! They've skim milk in their veins instead of blood.
Well, that's the reddest milk I've ever seen. My trenches are soaked.
That's
red
just about enough out of you,
I'm
Colonel.
Not going to mince words and stand on
Colonel Dax, if you continue in this manner, I shall have to place you under arrest.
It was so honest that it was shocking. And what, you know, made it even more shocking was the nature of the way it was shot. The use of the tracking camera in the trenches. There's something about an objective vision that's happening. They're trying to be objective to just show you, hey, I'm just showing you this, man. You make up your own mind, but I'm telling you right now, this is what went down, and it's bad, and it's a lie, it's hypocrisy.
Maybe the attack against the anthill was impossible. Perhaps it was an error of judgment on our part. On the other hand, if your men had been a little more daring, they might have taken it. Who knows? In any case, why should we have to bear any more criticism of the failure than we have to? Aside from the inescapable fact that a good many of your men never left the trenches, there's the question of the troops' morale. Don't forget that.
The troops' morale?
Certainly. These executions will be a perfect tonic for the entire division. There are few things more fundamentally encouraging and stimulating than seeing someone else die.
Many artists, when they put a canvas up, which is blank, they start with very detailed pencil strokes, very small, delicate pencil strokes on a canvas. Stanley started conceptually at all of his movies, from my point of view, with large, primary colored brush strokes. And he would just, like, beat out these concepts that were, you know, pretty obvious. when you look at Paths of Glory, every sequence hammers its points home, but within every sequence, the filmmaking is delicate and subtle and gentle almost.
I guess what really hit us was the end of the film. There's a tendency when you want to get to that kind of emotion or that level of sentiment, not sentimental, not sentimentality, but sentiment, and just portray this aspect of humanity. Very often, you know, you fall into sentimentality. You really do, and it's very, very hard. It's very hard to pull off. This one works like you cannot see it without weeping.
Als man ihm die Botschaft bracht, dass sein Herzliebchen im Sterben lag, da ließ er all sein Hab und Gut und eilte seinem Herzliebchen.
He was sitting behind his desk for this interview I was to have, because he was looking for an actress for that scene in Paths of Glory. And he, you know, I thought he looked extraordinary. And he just sat there beaming at me, grinning at me throughout the interview. And I must have grinned back. And he's been smiling at me for 43 years afterwards.
Following Paths of Glory, Christiana and her 3-year-old daughter, Katharina, moved with Stanley to Los Angeles. Stanley and Christiana were married in 1958, and Hollywood would be their home for the next few years, where they were to have 2 more children, Anya and Vivian. For its damning portrayal of the French officer class, Paths of Glory would be banned in France for nearly 20 years, but the film brought its director firmly to the attention of Hollywood. He was still only 28.
This is Stanley Kubrick. I think that if the reigning powers had any great respect for good pictures or the people who could make them, that this respect was probably very well tempered by the somewhat cynical observation that poor and mediocre pictures might just as well prove successful as their pictures of higher value. Television has changed this completely, and I think that despite the unhappy financial upheaval that it has caused in the movie industry, it has also provided a very invigorating and stimulating challenge, which has made it necessary for films to be made with more sincerity and more daring. If Hollywood lacks the color and excitement of its early days with Rolls Royces and leopard skin seat covers, I think, on the other hand, it provides the most exciting and stimulating atmosphere of opportunity and possibilities for young people today.
Slaves! You have arrived at the gladiatorial school of Lentulus Batiatus. Here you will be trained by experts to fight in pairs to the death. Obviously, you won't be required to fight to the death here. That'll only be after you've been sold. And then for ladies and gentlemen of quality, those who appreciate a fine kill. A gladiator's like a stallion, must be pampered. You'll be oiled, bathed, shaved, massaged, taught to use your heads. A good body with a dull brain is as cheap as life itself. I congratulate you, and may fortune smile on most of you.
Then Kirk Douglas came to us and was having trouble with Spartacus, and had shot for 3 days, and wanted to replace the director who was doing the film, and ask if Stanley could be acquired sort of on a loan-out basis. We thought it would be good for Stanley's career and for our company. Stanley, I thought, did an incredible job of taking that film, which the script didn't even have battle sequences in it, and sort of did some recasting of some of the parts, took some of the film to Spain and did the big battle scenes, and turned it into a marvelous epic film.
I was rather dreading the arrival of Stanley. I knew nothing about him, but I had seen Paths of Glory, which I find one of the best films I've ever seen.
In spite of your vices, you are the most generous Roman of our times.
Vices? Ladies.
Ladies, since when are they a vice?
So I had a very high opinion of him, but I also had a great affection for Tony Mann. And Tony Mann directed the early parts of the film, the ones in Death Valley. I think probably the studio wanted the reassurance of an older, more routine man. And Kirk always had the idea of wanting Stanley. So it was a very difficult task for him because we all had different acting styles. Olivier and Lawton hated each other. It was like two dogs.
I'll take a little Republican corruption along with a little Republican freedom, but I won't take the dictatorship of Crassus and no freedom at all. That's what he's out for, and that's why he'll be back.
And I look back now, I think he was 30 years old when he did it. Yeah, working with Olivier, Charles Lawton, and he was fearless.
If he was terrified, he didn't show it because he knew he mustn't. I think he had an extraordinary ability to concentrate on what is important. He did not allow himself to be sidetracked. And even if it was emotional turmoil and great worry, he wouldn't, that perhaps is a chess-playing thing, he wouldn't allow it to influence him. And I think that very soon the actors noticed, oh, yeah, you know, they were quite safe.
Traveled a long ways together. You fought many battles. You won great victories. Now, instead of taking ship for our homes across the sea, we must fight again. Maybe there's no peace in this world. For us or for anyone else, I don't know. But I do know that as long as we live, we must stay true to ourselves.
Its great virtue was it was the only film of that kind that didn't have Jesus in it. There was no trace of Christianity in Spartacus, really. There was faith, but not Christianity. Kirk wants to be rewarded for his courage, which I would certainly be the first to do so. To make a film like that without Jesus, but with Kubrick, is already a tremendous achievement.
But I think they were both fairly temperamental. Neither of them would give an inch, so there was tension. But he was uncomfortable during the making of that film, but not necessarily because of Kirk alone. It's because he had no rights over the script. He had all those things he got used to and fought for having. He didn't have. He had no say.
Stanley was unhappy because he was dealing with the star, who was also the producer and in charge of the production. And there were certain instances where he felt that things should be done differently, but because Kirk was in charge, they were done Kirk's way. And I'm not saying that Kirk was wrong or right, but nevertheless, Stanley said, from now on, I want to do pictures where I really have final cut.
The first overseas premiere of UI's screen epic Spartacus is the most brilliant event on London's show business calendar for the year. Director Stanley Kubrick and UI...
Spartacus was a critical and commercial success, winning 4 Oscars. Despite Kubrick's youth, he was now a recognized Hollywood director. But the process had also taught him that he had to have full control over his films.
I had a feeling that during Spartacus, he was biding his time, getting on the record as the director of a big and successful film, which would give him greater freedom in the future. And he did turn his career into that of an artist, whereas it could quite easily, had he surrendered at any juncture, have been that of a very successful journeyman.
He felt now he had this little label, I'm a film director, officially. Now, I can make a story that I have a crush on.
The interpretation of the image, where to place the camera, the nature of, the nature of the subject matter, which at that time, everything was opening up in the early 60s here in America, you know, and it was scandalous.
Put your head back. Put your head back. Open your mouth. You can have one little bite.
I think what a lot of people forget is just what a hot book Lolita was.
Originally, Nabokov couldn't get a publisher in the States or in the United Kingdom. So it was published as a dirty book in Paris. And it was in 1955 that Graham Greene in the Sunday Times in London nominated it as his novel of the year. It then took off and it very soon found a publisher.
He thought Lolita was a fantastic book because it clarified the feeling we all have that good and evil does not come in the expected package.
Well, I guess I won't be seeing you again, huh?
I shall be moving on. I must prepare for my work at Beardsley College in the fall.
Then I guess this is goodbye.
Yes.
Don't forget me.
It always shocks me when people say that Stanley didn't make people movies or movies about characters. He made movies about machines or you know, it's always confounded me when I've heard that. Lolita is, you know, it's nothing like the book, but he did draft the author to write the screenplay. So they were, you know, in collaboration with each other in another kind of version away from the novel that is much more about the human condition than I felt the novel ever was.
Lolita works as the very first Stanley Kubrick film for me, because I couldn't imagine anybody else making Lolita. It's a comedy, but it's got a lot of serious elements. It's risque. It's in your face. It's got big performances, and it works completely.
You're a disgusting, despicable, loathsome criminal!
Don't do that.
Get out of my way. Go on. Get out of my way! I'm leaving here today. You can have all of it, but you are never going to see that miserable brat again!
At a time when American cinema in the early 60s was on the way down, in other words, the studio system was finishing, this was a vision. This was somebody with authority making you look a certain way at things.
When I stood Adam naked, Adam naked, you should be ashamed of yourself, Captain. Before a federal law and all its thing and stars. Tarnation, you old horn toad. That's mighty pretty. That's a pretty poem. Because you took advantage. It's getting a bit repetitious, isn't it? Because, another one, because you cheated me. Because you took her at an age when young lads... That's enough. Say, what'd you take it away for, mister? That's getting kind of smutty there.
Because of its scandalous theme, the film had a crippling distribution problem.
The Catholic Church had their own censorship, and that if they condemned your film, they would then send notices to their churches, the Catholic churches all over the country, that it would be sinful to see this film.
Tom, you just touch me, and I go as limp as a noodle. It scares me.
Here's another feeling.
That held up the film for about 6 months, because they did condemn it. There was a picture of Lolita on the bedside stand. So when Humbert and his wife Charlotte were in bed, they felt that Humbert was using the picture for sexual stimulation. I denied that. I think that in all fairness, they were right. Anyway, we agreed to limit the number of looks at that picture.
To get a release, Kubrick had to recut Lolita. As he later told Newsweek, had I known how severe the limitations were going to be, I probably wouldn't have made the film.
There is a claim in the film world for Stanley Kubrick, director of Lolita, arriving with Mrs. Kubrick.
Lolita's strong performance at the box office was, no doubt, boosted by the controversy. Kubrick's next film would prove even more controversial.
Now then, Dimitri, you know how we've always talked about the possibility of something going wrong with the bomb. The bomb, Dimitri. The hydrogen bomb.
Everything wonderful about that movie is because of the way it was directed. Otherwise, you know, I thought there were flaws in the writing of the movie and flaws in some of the performances in the movie, but the directing of the movie was so bravura and so superb that it just, you know, was just a knockout.
the vision of just the opening credits and the use of music over the opening credits, we knew immediately anything could happen in this movie.
People remember the film because it deals with one of the most dark things of the post-war period. The idea, you know, that hanging over us was nuclear oblivion, that this was the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis. I mean, and it can't have possibly got closer than those few days where one mistake by either side could have started the World War III, quite literally. This piece of satire just hit it right on the button, and it was frightening, very, very frightening.
Well, now, what happened is one of our base commanders, he had a sort of, well, he went a little funny in the head. You know, just a little funny. And he went and did a silly thing. Well, I'll tell you what he did. He ordered his planes to attack your country. Well, let me finish, Dimitri. Well, listen, how do you think I feel about it?
He was able to say what we all knew about the madness of it. He had bought the book and was trying to make it straight and realized that he couldn't, that it was so utterly insane that it couldn't be done that way. And what he did was say that, that this is insane. I mean, it, please, who are we kidding?
Gentlemen, you can't fight in here. This is the war room.
And it ever after made it very difficult to take seriously the Strategic Air Command. I mean, they seemed like they were nuts from then on, and I think they probably were.
The most extraordinary part of Dr. Strangelove for me was that 30 years on, as part of a BBC team, I investigated over a period of like 2 years many of the central tenets in the film, what had happened in reality, what had happened to Strategic Air Command in the 50s and 60s, and the various elements of the film, like the idea that the military would take command against the president and use nuclear weapons without consulting him.
I was under the impression that I was the only one in authority to order the use of nuclear weapons.
That's right, sir. You are the only person authorized to do so. And although I hate to judge before all the facts are in, it's beginning to look like General Ripper exceeded his authority.
We're all, you know, seen as appalling when that film came out. Now we know that many of those elements were absolutely smack on. You know, Curtis LeMay, he actually did a test run to see whether you could provoke the Russians into war. We talked to a senior officer who'd worked for LeMay's successor, this is General Tommy Power. And they said this guy was basically psychotic. You know, this has not come out for 30 years, but there it is, right in the core of Strangelove.
Tell me, Jack, when did you first become, well, develop this theory?
Well, I first became aware of it, Mandrake, during the physical act of love. Huh. Yes, a profound sense of fatigue, a feeling of emptiness followed. Luckily, I was able to interpret these feelings correctly. Loss of essence. I can assure you it has not recurred, Mandrake. Women sense my power, and they seek the life essence. I do not avoid women, Mandrake. But I do deny them my essence.
Yes. The other films that were being made at the time about these themes, about the idea of nuclear war, a military takeover in the USA, films like Failsafe and 7 Days in May, they're very naturalistic and rather turgid films. They have no longevity, they don't endure. They're not films that you would watch for any reason except out of sociological interest. But people will watch Dr. Strangelove over and over again because it is so funny. And that was the genius of Kubrick, but also of his collaborators. I mean, he had the massive fortune to be working with two of the funniest people who have ever been involved in the film industry, Terry Southern and Peter Sellers.
What's happened, you see? The string in my leg's gone.
The what?
And the string I never told you, but you see, I've got a gammy leg. Oh, dear. Gone, shot off.
Stanley was his best audience. In fact, he spent many of the scenes just being an audience, not a director at all. He would simply put cameras everywhere he could so that when Peter was off flying high, Stanley says, I don't want anything to be lost. And he would just lie on his back, you know, roaring with laughter. That egged Peter on to ever greater heights.
Also, when they go down into the mine, everyone would still be alive. There would be no shocking memories. And the prevailing motion will be one of nostalgia for those left behind, combined with a spirit of bold curiosity for the adventure ahead.
One of the great things about his film is the scrupulous detail in which everything is, you know, and that's part of the power of it, the detail in Dr. Strangelove. You know, you would think that he had lived through that experience.
Survival kit contents check. In them you'll find 145 caliber automatic, 2 boxes of ammunition, 4 days concentrated emergency ration, 1 drug issue containing antibiotics, morphine, vitamin pills, pep pills, sleeping pills, tranquilizer pills, 1 miniature combination Russian phrase book and Bible.
While we were shooting, somebody had invited some American service personnel to come to Shepperton. They were terrified by the amount of accuracy we had in this aircraft. And the next day I got a memo from Stanley saying, you better make sure that you know where all your references came from, because otherwise we might be investigated by the FBI and so on. I discovered very quickly that behind this boyish enthusiasm and apparent naivety, there was this super brain and enormous power and utter dedication to movie making. You know, it was quite demoralizing at times when he changed his mind. But every time he did change his mind, it was for the better. But I learned a great deal on that film.
Sir! I have a plan. Monsieur! I can walk!
We'll meet again.
I was kind of shocked by it at first. It was so irreverent. And it was a time, it was the height of the Cold War. You know, I was at NYU at the time, but still my friends from the neighborhood that I saw the film with were somewhere at a Jesuit college called Fordham. Others were street kids. We all went up there to see this movie. They all loved it. And they were extremely conservative. The word on the street was, it's great.
I had a kind of a giddy exhilaration at the end when she was singing, we'll meet again, don't know where, don't know when. And he's riding the bomb. I thought, man, what kind of an imagination came up with this?
Dr. Strangelove caused uproar. Younger audiences loved its irreverence and anarchic humor, but many people saw it as dangerously subversive.
I remember reading a review in a Beverly Hills paper where the critic said that Stanley Kubrick should be physically harmed for having made that picture. That's a pretty bad review, I must say.
I can't remember any Stanley Kubrick movie that was released where there wasn't controversy. 2001, I remember very well. I remember Pauline Kael's review of 2001. They were not good reviews. And then 10 years goes by, and they're all classics.
By that time, I knew that Kubrick was the one, meaning that, yes, all these extraordinary directors around the world were making film after film, but there was something after you saw Lolita and Dr. Strangelove. I knew that Kubrick, we had to wait for a Kubrick film. And we knew that when we went to see it, that it was extremely special and that it was, we expected a lot from it, quite honestly. And in 2001, we got it.
By 1963, Stanley Kubrick had established so high a reputation that he could pick his next project without bowing to the dictates of Hollywood. As a director whose films were both popular and critically acclaimed, he had won an astonishing degree of creative independence. Stanley Kubrick now began work on a film which would establish him as one of the great film directors. With 2001, A Space Odyssey, The Boy from the Bronx would write a new chapter in cinema history. In the early 1960s, the age of space exploration began when both Russia and America sent men outside the Earth's atmosphere for the first time. As the space race came to dominate the popular imagination, Stanley Kubrick captured the spirit of the times by collaborating on film with the science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke.
Behind everyone alive today stand 30 ghosts, for that is the ratio by which the dead outnumber the living. Since the dawn of time, about 100 billion human beings have walked on this planet. Now, 100 billion is about the number of stars in our Milky Way galaxy. So this means that for everyone who's ever lived, there could be a star. Well, of course, stars are suns with planets circling around them. So isn't it an interesting thought that there's enough land in the sky for everyone to have a whole world? We don't know how many of those worlds are inhabited and by what kind of creatures. But one day we should know, perhaps by radio, perhaps by other means, perhaps by direct contact. The impact of that on the human race will be profound, especially if we encounter creatures far in advance of our own rather primitive species. Well, it's a wonderful thing to look forward to, and perhaps a terrifying one. It may happen in our lifetimes, it may not happen for 1,000 years, but one day we will know the truth about this incredible and wonderful universe around us, and perhaps understand our own place in it.
The extraordinary audacity, but also power and, I think, guts to say, let's just screech everything to a halt, take everybody back to prehistoric times where it wasn't that fast. Considering the way the world was moving so quickly at the time, this just said, no, 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 I want you to see something. I'm going to take you through something you never thought you'd ever experience.
His way of making a film was to concentrate on 7 or 8, as he called them, non-submersible units. And what this meant was you had a very good chunk, you had another good chunk, and when you had got 6 good chunks, you were almost home with a movie. It would be easy to connect them. And you can see this principle operating, in particular, in 2001, where I believe that the bits don't quite fit on. And this is why there's a mystery about 2001. It's what still interests people.
I just remember going to the theater and seeing the picture for the first time and feeling that it wasn't a movie. It was the first time that the motion picture form had been changed. It wasn't a documentary, and it wasn't a drama, and it wasn't really science fiction. It was more science eventuality.
Hal, despite your enormous intellect, are you ever frustrated by your dependence on people to carry out actions?
Not in the slightest bit. I enjoy working with people. I have a stimulating relationship with Dr. Poole and Dr. Bowman. My mission responsibilities range over the entire operation of the ship, so I am constantly occupied. I am putting myself to the fullest possible use, which is all, I think, that any conscious entity can ever hope to do.
unlike many a science fiction writer, including, I must say, myself, he regarded the future as unknowable. And this is the first movie, the first work of science fiction that actually, I think, depicts the future as unknowable.
18 months ago, the first evidence of intelligent life off the Earth was discovered. It was buried 40 feet below the lunar surface, near the crater Tycho. Except for a single, very powerful radio emission aimed at Jupiter, the 4-million-year-old black monolith has remained completely inert. Its origin and purpose still a total mystery.
I respect and awe, I mean, awe of the mystery of the universe, something which Einstein's, you know, often said, that anyone who isn't awed by the universe, well, they haven't any soul. So from my earliest days, the wonder of space and time has intrigued me, and Stanley and I tried to put some of this feeling into the film. I think it made people realize that we were a rather small part of an enormous universe. It's hard to realize that when we made that film, we didn't know what the Earth looked like from space, from any real distance. All these things had to be imagined.
The special effects in 2001 were a quantum leap forward for the film industry. These looked the real thing. Stanley had very firm and very specific ideas about how these models were to be lit. The painstaking attention to detail, the coloration, the dirtying up of the models. I mean, this really hadn't been seen before.
One of the best examples for my contribution to the film is what's known as the Slitscan sequence, the Stargate sequence. There was a lot of evolution to that concept of how you would be transported from one dimension to another. Was never really solved in the screenplay. And I had remembered, but knowing of an experimental filmmaker who was exploring this whole idea of long time exposures, and while the camera shutter is open, he would move various kinds of artwork or slits around in front of the camera to scan color blocks and objects onto the film in a rather unusual way. And I thought, well, if you took what he was doing, which was kind of flat and two-dimensional, and made it three-dimensional in the z-axis, that you could create this streak exposure. And the streak exposure is like a time exposure of car headlights on the freeway. If you leave the camera shutter open, a car headlight becomes a streak of light. It occurred to me that there might be some way to apply that to the Stargate sequence. And I walked that minute down to Stanley's office. Stanley, I think this is the answer to the Stargate. And he looked at it and he said, I think you could be right. And he said, just do whatever you need to do. You have carte blanche to do it. And that's an example of my whole experience on 2001, was support from Stanley to explore, experiment, take risks, and produce something that was different.
If you can imagine a giant Ferris wheel, and if you were to cover the Ferris wheel with a skin, on the inside edge of that skin, imagine the set being built, and imagine an endless hallway with things along the side. Well, that revolved. There's a scene where I come down a ladder, and the other astronaut, Gary Lockwood, is eating, apparently upside down, because he's on the other side of the centrifuge. And it looks like I walk upside down to him. How that actually was done was that Gary had a hidden harness. He was upside down, so I came in right side up, and they just revolved Gary down to me, and I just walked in place.
And there was this theme of constant rotating, rotating, rotating. The space station is rotating, the spacecraft is rotating, the Earth is rotating, everything's in orbit. And that established a style of intercuttable shots that ultimately later lent itself in Stanley's mind to the Strauss waltz.
always think the history of the cinema divides into two essential eras, before Stanley Kubrick and after Stanley Kubrick, especially in relation to the use of music in films. Before Stanley Kubrick, music tended to be used in films as either decorative or as heightening emotions. After Stanley Kubrick, because of his use of classical music in particular, it became absolutely an essential part of the narrative, intellectual drive of the film. In the use of Ligeti's music, I actually knew that piece of Ligeti, and I remember seeing 2001 and thinking, I'm hearing things. This can't possibly be Ligeti in a Hollywood film, but sure enough, it was. And of course, it makes the sequence utterly unforgettable.
It was for me, especially the visual fantasy with the speed, with the color and light changes when the spaceship goes down on a moon of the Jupiter, yeah? And then this, the speed is more and more and more, and it was very clear that Dr. Einstein pretended that the light velocity is the highest, you cannot go beyond, but in this film it was suggested as if it would be beyond the speed of light, and then we enter in another world.
I never know whether the images arose out of the music or the music arose out of the images, but perhaps the true thing to say is that they became, in his imagination clearly, and so have become in ours, totally inseparable.
When 2001 opened, like previous films of Kubrick's, it split both the critics and the audience.
The opening of 2001 was very frightening because we had all the executives sitting in the audience, very old, many of them, and they didn't understand the film at all and left, whole rows of them, and we were panic-stricken. Then there was an enormous, catastrophic meeting in our hotel room, and Stanley was so upset he lost his voice. We were up all night. Next morning we went to this house, and Stanley was battling on in New York, and I sort of fell with my clutching my handbag across my bed asleep because I hadn't slept all night, and woke up to the sounds of a DJ saying, "This is the most fantastic film, and the people are queuing around the block." And he was talking about 2001. And I was desperately trying to ring Stanley to tell him, "This, some people like it enormously. You know, it was just the Blue Rinse Brigade that walked out."
And he told me that the first exhibitor screening of 2001 had, I believe he said, 241 walkouts. You know, this is, I'm sure he counted them too.
When I first saw 2001, I didn't like it, and I was very disappointed. And then 3 or 4 months later, I was with some woman in California, and she was telling me what a wonderful film it was, and I went to see it again, and I liked it a lot more the second time I saw it. And then a couple of years later, I saw it again, and I thought, gee, this is really a sensational movie. And it was one of the few times in my life that I realized that the artist was much ahead of me.
A lot of people didn't get it the first time round, and I'm really fond of quoting the MGM executive who said, well, that's the end of Stanley Kubrick. But I think now the message has got over, even though we didn't intend a message specifically. More, you know, Stanley wanted to create an experience. And if any message, perhaps people will get different messages from it according to their own individual philosophies and outlooks.
2001 received a National Catholic Award for its imaginative vision of man's creative encounter with the universe. Some turnaround for Kubrick, who had so upset the Catholic Legion of Decency with Lolita. 2001 also won an Academy Award for Best Visual Effects. As the film's director and designer, Kubrick received his only ever Oscar.
It was that kind of process of personally taking possession of the not only the people, the technology, the art, the craft of making movies. He was it. He embodied the whole thing, and he invited actors, cinematographers, production designers to come into his family and collaborate with him, which for some people was difficult. After working with Stanley in 2001, I swore I would never work for anybody again, because Stanley was a hell of a taskmaster. He was difficult, he was demanding, his level of quality control was just astronomically near perfection, and I found as a young guy this was very hard. His mind was so insatiable and so active that he could barely sleep. He could barely stop. I saw that Stanley Kubrick worked and lived his work 7 days a week, almost 24 hours a day. And I think probably he had a hard time keeping up with his own intellect.
Kubrick now turned to a mighty historical character whose triumphs, failures, and personality had always fascinated him. Napoleon.
Napoleon is still in his grave, waiting to be brought back to life. I wonder what Napoleon would think of Lew Wasserman and David Picker. Whether he would like to have them passing judgment on his life.
Napoleon represented for him the worldly genius that at the same time failed. And Stanley was fascinated by the fact that somebody so intelligent and so talented could make such mistakes.
He liked comparing war and chess and chess and making films and the idea of seeing everything as a battle.
All directors like battle analogies for movies, and certainly nobody planned with the mixed results. When somebody that was meticulous plans something, anything that goes wrong seems to wreak havoc.
If Stanley was afraid of anything, it was of making these kind of mistakes, whereby you get carried away without checking thoroughly. There was the chess player in him. You could say maybe that's why he took so long between films. The Napoleon project was well prepared. We were ready to go to Romania, where we could have 5,000 pieces of cavalry, including all the men and commanding officers. And we had paper uniforms and everything ready. And then came this film, Waterloo. It was a very well-made film with Rod Steiger, but for some reason, it failed at the box office, and our backers got scared and pulled out.
By 1969, the Kubrick family was living close to the film studios in Elstree, Hertfordshire.
He's always liked living here. There were moments where he was homesick for New York, but he was aware that that was a New York that no longer existed. I don't know, when you brought up your children here and all your children's friends live here and, you know, get attached.
Do you know what kind of a camera that is? What it's called?
It's a home movie.
Arriflex it's called.
I watched the video of me as a very fresh 10-year-old, being very fresh to him. But also him being bossy and too impatient and putting his director's hat on in an inappropriate way.
Get him off, Anya. Anya, get him off. We're shooting. Grab him and get him off.
And even as a child, I remember thinking, I'm sure you're not supposed to talk to me like this.
Do you often find me in a temper?
Yes.
Oh, I don't believe that. I can't believe that.
Well, you better believe it, because you just went in a temper a couple of minutes ago.
Yeah, because you can't do a stupid film, because everyone giggles.
Then I can't play like that.
I think I'm one of the most even-tempered people you'll ever meet.
Kubrick had found privacy and tranquility in England. But this idyllic world was about to be torn apart by his next project, an adaptation of Anthony Burgess's controversial novel, A Clockwork Orange.